Hey guys, this is Level Up session 76 with Artgerm.
Yay.
So, hey man, hey Stanley.
Hey, hello, how guys?
Hey man, so before we start, I just have a quick announcement to make. Since we didn't have a session in like half a year probably, the Facebook group is going crazy and there's tons of people joining. And if you don't know our Facebook group, make sure to go there. There's plenty of people supporting themselves with art and feedback. So this group needs a lot of attention to filter spam and so on. So I actually managed to get some people involved. And I just want to give a shout out to a couple of people that are managing the group day to day. It would be impossible for me, Darek, and Jonas to do it. So here are the people. Mona Halbish, Luke Chop, I will try my best to read the names, Sinara Pan, Juan Gastelum, Martin Nebelon, Paul Wolf, Aaron Simon, Dennis Matei, Carl Moses Bede, Marie-Claude Yanon, Rodrigo Vera, Depaxayo, Raz Van Cosman, and I cannot pronounce it, and Sebastian Leon Silva. So thank you a lot, guys, for doing it. Without you, this Level Up group on Facebook wouldn't exist. So thank you, guys. And yeah, right now we can move to our guest. Stanley, hello. We are really, really happy to have you here.
Yeah, likewise.
Awesome. So this is a great comeback. It's just amazing to have you here today. And so yeah, Artgerm is an illustrator, designer, concept artist, creative director, and co-founder of Imaginary Friend Studios. I bet we all know his work, and we are all familiar with his stuff. And you joined us today to share a little bit of your knowledge, insights into your work, your early work as well, which is a pretty traditional thing to share online. And what else? There will be a giveaway, right?
Yes, there'll be some giveaways. Prepare two hand sketches. Later on, I will ask some questions, basically two questions. So pay attention during the live stream. And then, whoever got the answer will get those sketches for free. Shipped.
That's awesome.
Of course, yeah.
That's perfect. So we have a lot of questions prepared for you, both from the Level Up poll that we run. And yeah, later there will be, I guess, a live demo or of some sort. We'll try to do it, guys. So we'll try to do it. And yeah, so let's get started. I think our first question will be how it all started with you. And we would love to see some of your very first work, since I've been a fan of your work since my very beginnings. I've been looking up to your portraits and line quality and the way you portray women from the very first time I saw your artwork. It inspired me a lot. But I'm actually super interested in how it all got started and how your characters you're drawing today were born. So maybe you can elaborate on that a little bit.
Sure. Well, I've been drawing since age of 15. Drawing has always been my interest and my passion, and that's pretty much something that I just only thing I want to do. I'm not interested in studying and all those academic stuff, so I spend most of my days in school doodling on my textbooks and just mess things up. And because of the interest, I decided in my teenage that I decided to be an artist when I grew up. So since then I've been drawing a lot and practice daily. Back then, there wasn't even Wacom tablet. There wasn't even internet, just like books and stuff. So I'm pretty much a self-taught artist. I would say that I do not have any formal training in art. The only formal training I had was graphic design.
Okay. Yep. So that was back in 2000s or even before?
Even before. I mean, I'm old. I'm 42 years old this year. Yeah.
I wouldn't tell you 42.
42?
Yeah.
Are you kidding?
I can't tell you there. Yeah.
You can tell.
Awesome. Yeah, Asian. Yes.
Okay. Yeah, Asian.
Yep. So because of that, After I graduated from my high school, I took a diploma in graphic design, and that's a 3-year diploma because that was the only formal education I have in something creative. Mm-hmm. And before I graduated, I was employed as an art director in an advertising company called O&M. It's an international advertising company. And I spent 3 months there and got really sick of the politics running in the studio. And I said, okay, screw this. I'm going to do something else. So I started another advertising company with my friends and doing communication designs and advertising, brochures, logos, branding stuff. And running that for 5 years and then got tired of that because I could not have a chance to draw. I only like do layout and stuff. Yeah. That was really boring. So I said, okay, I'm going to quit. I'm going to start something that I really wanted to do. So I get a few friends of mine and start up Imaginary Friend Studios. And this is our 10th gear running the studio.
That's amazing. Congratulations. So I have a question. How this graphic design diploma and experience helped you with developing your drawing skills? Would you consider the time spent on graphic design as wasted, or you needed it actually, and you learned a lot?
Well, within those 3 years, I think it gave me a lot of time to learn things by myself. The school provide a very basic introduction course to everything around graphic design, such as layout, software skills, and topography and stuff. So it did help me quite a bit, so that it actually somehow enhanced my graphic sense. And as you can see in my artworks, that I do enjoy putting some graphic elements.
Yeah. Like your fake covers with.
Yes, correct. Yeah.
Yeah, that is perfect. Yeah.
That actually improved my sensitivity towards space, like shapes and graphic elements. So that's something that I find really helpful.
That's amazing. So there is one question in the poll that I think would be appropriate to ask now. And it has a lot of votes. I'm 28, and am I too old for the art industry? I mean, it's probably for the beginner. So
yeah, I think people like to ask such question. Yeah. Let's break it down a little bit. Are you too old for art? Not at all. I mean, you are never too old for art. Mm-hmm. But if you're talking about being a professional, working as a professional artist or designer, in the industry, age does make a little bit of difference, especially your commitment in life. You know, when you were young, we are carefree, you know, we can do anything that we want. We have no financial obligations, we have no family to feed, we just live alive as a young kid. Mm-hmm. But as you get older, some of these challenges will come in. For example, you're starting a family, or your parents got retired, and you start to sustain them financially, and those age will come into play. So, which means that if you can start earlier, it'll be the best. But I would say that 28 is not actually that old. It's just that you need to know that you're running a bit late, so that you need to double up and really speed speed up your progress as much as you can. Yeah.
Perfect. So just after you establish and to get into, can you hear me?
Oh yeah.
So after you established Imaginary Friend Studios, I have a question about regarding your style and your skills and how it's developed over the years. Would you consider you started Imaginary Friend Studios with your style already set? Or it was a longer process, and how did it work?
I've never considered my style is set up to today. You know, I think my style is still evolving based on my preference in life at this part of time. I change my style accordingly. But I would say that being brought up in the East, I was born in Hong Kong, so that I grew up with a lot of Asian stuff, anime, manga, even martial art comic in Hong Kong. Those gave me a very strong influence, and it somehow shaped my earlier stage of my style. Only when I came to Singapore, when I was being exposed to more Western content, especially online, that I start to see that my style has changed. Now it's more or less a blend of Asian and a bit of Western look of that. So I kind of like it because many times when clients from the West, for example, DC and Marvels, when they come to me, that I'll be able to give them a very interesting spin to the characters that is slightly Asian, not exactly, slightly. But at the same time, when Asian client come to me, for example, Japanese client, they'll be able to internationalize the properties because of the Western slant I have. So,
That's awesome. Yeah, it gives you this quality of being in the middle in terms of the style and providing some really unique pieces of artwork. So in regards to developing your own style and working over the years to actually have your own language like that, how would you tell, can you practice efficiently? This is one of the top questions in our poll, actually. How do you practice efficiently? What do you think?
I always believe that, many times when young artists ask more high-level artists, like, how do you improve? Many times they get the answer that, oh, you need to practice, you need to draw often, you need to draw as much as you can. I mean, that's true in a sense, but it's not a complete answer. To me, that I always believe that art requires, I have a little formula, actually, to talk about improvement. It's basically, you need to understand the theory of how things work in life, the theory of lighting, fundamentals, colors, anatomy. And then with the theory, you observe. It means you step out of your room, step out of your classroom, and look around and try to solidify the understanding, the theory, by observing reality. And with that, then you apply into your work on a regular basis as much as you can. That, in that sense, you have a higher chance of improvement. And the important thing is whenever you do a new piece of work, try to give yourself a bit of a challenge that something you have not done before, maybe a new composition, maybe a new color palette, maybe it's a new perspective, something that's slightly out of your comfort zone. I think that will actually help you improve. Yeah.
So in regards to your own improvement, is there anything, any work you could show us that would show us your improvement over the years? And what or were the things you remember you were struggling with yourself the most over?
I'll show you two of my earlier works, I was posted it up a while ago. So let me share the screen.
Okay.
All right, this is the first one.
The one on the left?
The one on the left was done in 1989. Awesome. Yeah, 1989. Ooh. That was like 15 years ago.
Me and Darek weren't even born.
Yeah, correct,
We weren't even in plants.
We haven't. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, you're still up in the air. Yeah, I know. So just when I was age 15, and 3 years ago or 4 years ago, I actually redo that same piece with my knowledge. 4 years ago. Yeah, that was some of my earlier works. You can see that I still like to draw women, in my earlier days. Yeah. And then I'll show you another one.
The progression is terrifying.
Yeah. Crazy. Okay, this is another one that I did. Again, that was done in 1988, and I spent I think about a day to finish that piece on the left. And then the right one was something that I did like 2 years ago in class, and that took me about 20 minutes. Yeah.
Wow. That's crazy.
So you like to dust off your old stuff and just see how the old ideas comes to life with your new knowledge, right?
Usually I don't do that. I mean, I usually don't edit my old works because I like that become part of my history, of my growth. So I think recently I see many people online, especially on DeviantArt, that they like to do this draw again thing. So I say, oh, give it a shot. Let's try to redraw some of my over and see how it looks like, just for the sake of inspiration. And just to tell people one simple and important fact is that you need art takes time to improve. That's what I'm trying to say.
Because sometimes the past ideas are really cool, but your skills maybe not make up for it yet. And then you just try to, you know, bring it back on the table again. So
there are a lot of people asking, where is Jonas? And guys, I have no idea. Please spam his Facebook.
No, I'm not.
Where the hell is he? Because he was supposed to be here now, probably sleeping somewhere in the world. But okay, I have another question. Is it important to have many drawing styles, or you should focus only in one to get better? Like, what do you think about this? should you get lost with your styles or focus just on developing one? What do you think?
Yeah, I like to get lost in my style, actually. In fact, in my earlier days, when I started Pepper Projects, when I created my own character, Pepper, I render her or I draw her in a different style. The idea is very simple, is that I would like to expand my comfort zone as much as I can. I mean, we all work the best within our comfort zone, but I would like my comfort zone to be bigger. So something really stylized to something very realistic, something Asian to something Western, I would like to be able to do that just to enjoy the diversity of art. Mm-hmm. So, of course, at the end of the day, whether you hold one style or many style, it's not so much of the question. The problem is that, I mean, the question is that, are you able to solidify those styles and make it consistent and eventually become one of your own? I don't have, in fact, when I employ artists in my studio, I would like to see them being able to work on different styles so that at times when they need to collaborate together on different kind of projects, sometimes it's really hardcore bloody stuff, sometimes very child-friendly stuff, I would like them to be able to jump into different projects because of the diversity in their skill set. Yeah.
Yeah, it's just having this open mind and being, I mean, brave enough to step out and try to learn new things and actually apply them to your own workflow. I tend to do it as well. I tend to paint very different styles constantly. It keeps me fresh, you know. Keeps me
Those polygonal portraits that you did was excellent.
No. Oh, thank you. I didn't know you knew my work. Thank you so much.
Of course, I knew.
It actually makes you even more attractive on the market when you have more various, you know.
And I guess it fits also, I mean, not only illustration, but concept work too. Like, if you are being able to fit into more production styles, to of course, there are these concept artists that are doing really specific work, so they're just doing one thing, but there are concept artists that can manage stylized, realistic.
Yeah, but that's exactly what I'm talking about. I mean, I talk to my student about it. Many times young artists today, they are so intrigued by the idea of concept art. And many times you see concept art online, it's about environment art, like mechanical designs, or something that's rough and quick and realistic. So they tend to focus on getting something look realistic. But at the same time, you know that in our world, there are many franchises or many properties doesn't require you to draw something realistic. For example, if you're going to conceptualize Angry Bird, I don't believe that Angry Bird requires speed painting. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, so it's really the diversity of art itself. I think you need to allow yourself to expand into different areas.
So another question from me, I think that is that goes along with the previous one. How many hours do you put in art every day yourself? Like, what is your daily routine, so to speak, now when you're running a studio, you have a big professional career, and how do you manage to keep your productivity going and inspiration?
Yep, it was tough. I mean, back when I was younger, I have more time to draw. I have at least 8 hours a day to draw, just focus on drawing. But now running a studio, I have much less time. I would say about 6 hours? Depends. No, for the whole week. Some days I tend to draw more, some days I tend to draw less. Depends on the commitment in with my family.
Exactly.
And my school, of course.
How many people are working with you in your studio actually?
My studio have gone through a very interesting roller coaster ride. we started off as a 5 of us, and then eventually we increase our number to, like, we have 60 people, 60.
Whoa, that's a lot.
Yeah, that was crazy, and I hardly have time to draw. And now we are down to about 6 of us, yeah.
Six? Oh, so that's 10 times less. Is it because of how the business affected your life, or is that was just the way you wanted the studio to work, or?
Yeah, I think eventually, right, we realized that having such a friendly studio that everybody treat others like family, sometimes it works as a double-edged sword, that we get to stick around together and have a lot of fun, but it also reduced the motivation for individual artists to build their own name, to expand their own fan base because they are just too comfortable working in the studio. Yeah. So after running that for many years, we decided that maybe there's a better chance for them to try to go solo, to be independent artists. At the same time, we still provide them with projects constantly. And up to the point that they can stand on their own and really have their own clientele, I think that would be my ideal, which they are all, most of them are doing that now. Yeah.
Nice.
That's perfect. That's a great transition.
It's good because you're also thinking about others who are creative, but because it's sometimes it's really easy to jump into that trap when you are just too comfortable with working with surrounding, you know, people around you. And
So
hey, Jonas is here.
Oh, there you go, the late man.
Hey guys.
Hey.
What's up, dude? There are a lot of people asking for you in the chat.
I'm really sorry, man. I'm really sorry. Actually, I had a little problem, so that's why I'm a bit late. But I won't disturb you guys. Keep going. I'll just work my way in. Okay. But yeah, hi, everyone.
Okay, awesome. So yeah, full squad here after half a year. That's good. That feels good. All right, let's move to a couple of other questions that we have. I guess I will keep the technical questions in regards to painting to the demo stage we will have later, so I don't want to go there right now, but what do you think are the most common mistakes you see beginners make? Since you're teaching too, you probably have a lot of insights into that. So,
yeah, I would say art fundamentals. Many young artists nowadays, they tend to ignore that. I won't blame them because many students that come to my school, they are inspired by anime, manga, comic stuff. And they start learning to draw how people draw it, like in the manga, in anime. So they are learning fundamentals through someone else's style. For example, many of them come in to draw muscles like Dragon Ball. So if you draw muscle anatomy like Dragon Ball, there's no way for you to get out of it because that was your starting point. So my advice for the young artists is always to go back to the fundamentals, to understand that the art style that you're loving today, the origin of art style come back to realism. So to me, that is important. Not that I want them to draw something realistic. I want them to have a good solid foundation so that they can build a style on top of that. Yeah.
Yeah, that's a great insight. And you're talking about like borrowing from the style, but purposefully, so with an intent, and deconstructing it, understanding it, and then borrowing it. Are there any artists like that for you that inspired you over the years that you would hang pictures of their work on your wall? And is there anything, any person like that?
Funny to say that, but I don't really have those like, I'm not really a fanboy of a particular artist, but I really enjoy the diversity of art that the art industry can provide. But I do have some names that I really enjoy. I mean, for example, I like Ashley Wood's stuff because of the graphic and very sketchy graphic, very energetic kind of artworks. Yeah. I also like artists like James Jeans, that he's excellent with his craft, with the Asian aesthetics and stylistic. It's amazing.
Yeah.
I like Yoji Shinkawa, the concept artist of Metal Gear Solid, that he is able to put in very abstract way to present concept art at the same time with really good foundation. I love his stuff. So
I've seen it for the recent one. That's just too good. So
very good. So.
I want to talk a little bit about Pepper, actually. I think your most famous character, I guess. And
I believe
so. How it all started with her, and maybe you can show us a visual journey, if that's possible. What was the very first artwork you created of her, and how it all started? Then were all the style experiments you did? I don't know. I would love to talk about it. I remember seeing the Pepper stuff on DeviantArt years ago.
Okay, let me show my screen.
Yeah, sure.
Okay. Yep, this is some of my Pepper stuff. Pepper was created many years ago, I would say more than 10 years ago, when I was still running an advertising agency. Back then, I was being appointed as a senior art director, so my job was to inspire my designers with different kind of art direction. So with that in mind, and also that as I mentioned earlier, that I didn't have much time to draw. So I want to create a little project for myself to explore different art style, expand my comfort zone, and just have fun drawing. Yeah. That's how I created her, with that in mind. So my first paper project, paper artwork, probably is something like this. The background was my studio back then. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Yeah, that's awesome. So actually, what is the idea behind their design, and what was the inspiration for it? It looks like she has some sort of headphones on.
Yeah.
Futuristic. Yeah.
Pepper has no backstory.
So it's just it's just a visual thing to inspire you.
She's just a toy. She's just a toy for me to play around with, to interpret her in different ways. In fact, up to today, I have no idea how she looks like.
Mm. Yeah, right? Because she changes every time you change the style.
Yeah, she looks so different every time I draw her. So I just like that to enjoy interpreting her in different ways. Of course, with the headphone, there's some consistency involved that with summer, I cook up some kind of idea later on. After 5-6 years, I decided to make her into some kind of interdimensional career. She's just a special agent that jumped into different dimensions. Whichever dimension she jumped into, her style transformed into that dimension. For example, if she jumped into a Hello Kitty world, she would look like one of the Hello Kitty characters, for example.
Yeah, that's interesting. So can we maybe count for some kind of an art book from you or any sort of publication? Since, to my knowledge, you haven't really... did anything like this, right?
Yeah, so basically, because of the popularity of Pepper, artists on DeviantArt start making their own version or their own fan art of Pepper. So because of that, I ran a contest many years ago on DeviantArt to invite artists around the world to submit their own version of Pepper. And then I think within a month, I have about 1,005 entries.
Oh, God. That's a big book already.
Actually, with that, I actually selected 100 of them and compiled them into my first Pepper art book. Yeah.
That's great. So it's already out?
It was out like many years ago. Like, this is the cover. This is the cover. Yeah. Mm.
There you go. I didn't know about it. That's awesome.
I can send you one. No problem.
That's awesome. Yeah, I would love to grab one. Yeah, that's beautiful. So are you still enjoying drawing her? Like, are you still going in there and trying to experiment, or you would rather go somewhere else now? Like, do you feel like you're done with this character?
No, I think I'm not done yet. In fact, this year will be interesting because I'll be announcing a second round of the Pepper projects.
Mm. That's great. Yeah, that's exactly what I'm thinking
about. Let me show you some stuff, all right?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah.
Alrighty. So, Jonas?
Okay.
Okay, there you go. Go ahead.
Yep, so basically this is a new Pepper, and she's now turning into a statue. Mm.
Nice.
Oh, that will be that will be something we can buy and stand
yes, something you can buy. Yeah. It's actually now currently is produced by Sideshow Collectibles. Yeah. So awesome. There'll be a 1/5 scale or 1/4, 1/5 scale statue. Yeah.
That's pretty big, right?
That's really huge. Yeah. Yeah. So this is a base design. There's a space station below her as a base. So. Mm.
Wow, that's awesome. Love the color themes and
the rhythms. We'll be coming out this year. Mm.
That's
perfect.
Cool,
Alrighty, let's move on to some other questions, and then I think we'll be ready to move to the demo part, since we are already half an hour in.
That's fast.
Yeah, that's fast, right? Time flies when we are doing these live
sessions. I thought people would ask me more nasty questions. Yeah.
Okay, people in the chat, if you have any questions to Artgerm, we are looking at the chat, please type them in. I'm also borrowing them from the poll, but yeah, make sure to type them in there too. So, another one. When you were just beginning in your career as an artist, what was the best criticism you received that led you where you are today?
Honestly, I don't remember any.
Yeah.
I think I think the problem in my journey in my art is that I didn't have a mentor that I can learn from.
Yeah.
There wasn't even internet, as I say. So many times I tried to figure things out myself, and I took a long, long route until I get to where I am today. So but I would say that to give some tips to the young artists now, I would say that art requires a lot of passion, and most importantly, to have fun with your artworks. Many times people talk about discipline and stuff like that, but to me, the most compelling, the most motivating things I have with my art is that because I'm having fun with it. It's just like playing games. Many of us like to play games, and we don't need discipline to play games. We need discipline not to play too much game. So if you can make art as fun as playing games, you are set. You will devote everything, all the time that you have, to make it work, because you are just having a lot of fun with it.
So in regards to the artists that are just starting out, I think a lot of people can relate to you, since most of the people that are watching Level Up are self-taught and trying to get better, struggling, and looking for the knowledge online. So without any like proper structured education, what would be your advice? Where to look for knowledge now? How to set up this art fundamentals? These art fundamentals you were talking about.
That's a very challenging thing, because nowadays, because you have so much information online about art, tutorial on YouTube and stuff, not all the time that the knowledge that you get online, they are reliable. And many times it actually confuses you further.
Yeah, that's true. That's what I experienced.
Yeah, so I would say that if possible, learn from something more structured. I don't mean art school. I mean, for example, you can go to more structured online tutorial on, I don't know, on can be as simple as on Gumroad, that you download some tutorials, or you can go to Schoolism to actually learn from some of the so-called masters in the industry. But provided you have the discipline to follow through, because I realize that many students I have, they prefer being taught face-to-face rather than a self-learning kind of a structure. But I also understand that not many people has the luxury to fly to somewhere else or to actually sign up for art school. But I would say that the best way for you to do it at this point of time is that pick up some books on traditional art. Learn from some of the traditional master how they do it. The terminology that they use may be very different. For example, nowadays we use, there's ambient occlusion here. In the past, they talk about, there's highlight, there's mid-tone, there's shadow. Mm-hmm. They talk about very different terminology, but I would say the underlying knowledge is the same. We just need to figure that out and modernize it.
So what I found also during my own path, it was that grabbing tutorials from Gumroad was a little bit like collecting stamps, less than really learning. But where I saw my own improvement, where actually I think the closest thing to actually learning in school were these Schoolism CGMA courses that were actually involved. That actually involved an instructor talking to you directly. They're a little bit more expensive, but I think they are. They're putting that discipline on you.
Yeah, that's right.
Gumroad tutorials done. You have to have this discipline to actually pursue Gumroad knowledge. But you know, I think the closest you can get to an art school actually are these online courses, and they're really good. Mm. There's a lot of great courses out there that we can learn from. That's for sure.
And I think it's also very important for young artists to be in a community, because being who I am, I always believe art as a community rather than competition. So you need to find a community that is positive, motivating, and inspire each other to work harder. I think that is important. For example, Level Up is one of the good portal that you can tap into. But in a smaller group, within your own country, within your own like peers, I think if we can gather a few of you guys that to have some more structured way of learning and inspire each other, I think that will learn much faster.
Yeah,
that's a great advice. I think now
plenty of questions actually.
Yeah, there's plenty of questions. We can go on and on.
Let's do it, man. I have plenty of time. Monday is busy.
That's an attitude that we love, you know. That's an attitude we love. So
Yeah, I think one that was repeated quite a couple of times, and it relates to art block. Because you seem to be very positive about what you are doing and quite open about it. But there are some people who are not even in the industry yet, but they seem to have art block. And I think every artist have art block, especially when they are burnout, when you work too hard or, you know, overwork yourself. It happens to me as well. I just have sometimes, you know, the art block as well. So how do you manage to deal with it, actually?
Well, I don't have art blocks. That's the truth. but I only have lack of time to draw. That's also the truth.
Yeah.
I think for some of you guys who actually experienced art block, especially for young artists, many times they experience art block when they have this habit of start thinking about what to draw when they sit in front of the computer, when they open up the sketchbook. To me, that may give you a higher chance of art block. To me, it's important that you archive, you record your ideas on a regular basis.
Mm-hmm.
Not in front of the computer, not in front of the sketchbook, but anytime the idea comes to your mind, it's precious. You need to record them, make a little sketch, thumbnails, so that when you have time to really draw, you can sit down and really have plenty of ideas that you can play around with. But in a situation that you actually, in the art block, I would prefer not to deviate from it, which means that I would not choose to, okay, let's play a game for one month and
get inspired.
I don't think that would work. I mean, it will pull you away from art forever. But I would say that let's go back to something simpler. Start drawing something that you don't need to think much. Your little character that you like to draw, your little doodle, a random stuff, something that's even minus, that will get you back on track and get back to momentum.
So you're talking... Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, what I sometimes experience with this, because it's a good suggestion that you give, but I sometimes feel like when you have an idea and you jot it down for later usage, that when you kind of get back to it at a later stage, you don't feel the same connection anymore with it because you're out of that context of mind or out of that mindset. So it's for me personally, it's really hard to pick up old stuff because I'm just kind of not excited about it anymore because it feels old in a way. Even though it's not, you know, like some old ideas are much better than stuff that I could think of right now. But for some reason, just because it's been laying around, I lose my connection with it. You know what I mean?
Yes, of course. In fact, right, many people like to suggest this. When you have an idea, don't start working on it. Let it sit in your mind for a day or two. If 2 days later, when you look at the idea again, and you still find excited about it, then you start drawing it. I think I like to do it the same because on weekends I can't draw. I devote all my time with my family. So I like to make mental sketches, mental doodles, and I like to make thumbnails in my mind. And if after Saturday and Sunday, when Monday I go back to my studio and I still feel excited about it, then I will start drawing it. Yeah.
Do you think that's the skill you acquire over time, like this mind sketching thing, or you actually have it from the beginning, even as the person that still doesn't understand art fundamentals? Do you think you need this core to work in order to sketch mentally and record these ideas, or?
Yes, of course. Fundamental is the backbone of everything to me. You need to understand that all of us has this ability to sketch something from imaginations. But the problem is that, the question is that, are the references in your mind reliable? Many times they are not, because they are just exaggerated stuff. They are not grounded in
reality.
And understanding. I mean, I'm not like Kim Jong-gi kind of style. I can see everything in my mind and draw it out. So I need to train up my mental models, which I use this term with my students, is that, for example, for people like me who like to draw characters, there's always this mental model. It's like actor, actress, that in my mind, that when I first started working with this actor, actress in my mind, they can only give me very simple poses. In a certain angle, they can't pull that off. But as I train them up more and more and start teaching them how to pose with observations of things I see, understanding that I get, they start to be more capable of posing something more difficult for me. And that is what the basis of the mental sketch. You need something that is reliable for you to sketch things out. And it's not something that is some high-level shit that you need to, only up to that level, then you become awesome. It's not. It's just that because my limitations, I do not have the luxury to hold a sketchbook all the time to draw, for now. So I rely a lot more on my mental, my brain, to actually sketch those things out for me. If I don't see anything interesting in my mind, at least up to 70% of the completion, I will not even start sketching it out digitally. Yeah.
That's good.
That's a great idea. And what usually inspires you when you are out, let's say, and suddenly you're caught by this mind image you have? What is usually that is getting you on track with it?
Okay. Many times because of the things that's happening around us. I mean, things are in trend, trending online, mm-hmm. or things I recently watch, recently read. Not really from art, you know. It can be from mm-hmm. the movies, can be from the book, the magazine that I read, that inspires me. Yeah. Or the toys that I bought that inspires me. Yeah.
There are another questions from the people who are interested in how to get into the industry. What do you think about posting your works on big sites like ArtStation, DeviantArt, or just actually marketing yourself?
Yeah, I think the world has changed a lot nowadays with social media. One good thing about that is that your work get to be seen by people easier. But at the same time, your work will be face a lot of criticism mm-hmm. easily. So it comes as a bundle. You cannot avoid them. So being able to post your work and make it viral is one good thing. But at the same time, you need to be prepared that there are also lots of trolls around who will tell you what to do, how to live your life as an artist, what you should draw, what you should not draw. Yeah, there are many experts out there, which I don't know them.
Be really careful. With progressive growth, it also grows the number of people who are doing it. So if you are not doing something that's noticeable, it can get lost pretty easily, right?
Yeah, maybe I can actually talk a little bit more about that. Because many times...
That would be awesome. Yeah,
students come to me and say, hey, sometimes I got very nasty comments on my Facebook page, and then I feel very depressed. I feel depressed for a month, for weeks, that I don't feel like drawing. Then my answer to them is very simple, that you have 1,000 followers on your Facebook, and you feel sad by one random comment.
Yeah.
That you sacrifice the rest of the 100 fans that who love your work is totally not worth it. Yeah.
Exactly.
I mean, yeah. So I think it's important to know that there's constructive criticism that when you draw six fingers, people point it out. You should admit it. Yeah. But if you draw the leg longer, the boob bigger, the hand shorter, that's become your personal aesthetic choice. To me, I will not bother by that. Mm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So it's kind of sometimes hard to recognize whether it's a mistake or a stylistic choice. I bet you can tell by your experience when it's intentional, when it's not. So what's your strategy, so to speak, with your struggling students? Like when somebody is constantly making same mistakes and it's really hard for him to learn, how would you approach such a student, and how would you develop, I don't know, a curriculum for that type of a person? Because I always find a person that's learning really fast and people that are learning slower, even though they're putting the same amount of practice into the subject. Have you noticed something like this too?
Yeah, well, I think it's important whenever you do practice, for example, your studies, it's important to set some objective to that and need to focus on a smaller area. For example, we talk about anatomy. You don't always have to draw poses. Maybe today, you just want to pick up the sketchbook, walk out of the door, go to a cafe, a Starbucks, and just look at people's hand and draw their hands. And just focus on small part of it to tighten your understanding. Because many times that we draw by perceptions, we don't draw by understandings. Many times, students come to me and say, how do you draw foreshortening, for example? Then I would say, okay, so do you have problem drawing a frontal face of a person? You say, no. But I say that because in the frontal face, your nose is foreshortened, your ears are foreshortened. How come you don't have a problem drawing that? Because they just look at it often enough and they draw often enough. So many of this, because no matter how we look at a person, it's always foreshortened. Always. So because of that, you need to always define the objective of your training and make your training small but important. For example, today I just want to draw hair. I don't want to draw anything else but to draw hair. But this is interesting to say, because many people devote their life just to do studies. They do nothing but studies. Oh, study of this, just study of that. But I believe that in order to make your art grow, you need to take care of two different areas of your art. First is the fundamentals. Second one is the passion. So you need to draw something that you love all the time. At the same time, spend time to do study and train up your fundamentals. And these two must go concurrently. You cannot do either or. Otherwise, when you level up your fundamentals, you lose your passion. Or you level up your passion, you lose your fundamentals. You both must do together. Yeah.
Yeah, that's very true. That's a great advice, actually. So I would love to move to the practical part now, and maybe we can keep the questions going still.
Is there a break for us to actually a 5 minutes break or something?
Yeah, we can do a 5 minutes break and talk with our buddies here. Yeah, sure, dude. Like we can grab a break, like 5 minutes, and once you will be back, let us know, and we can talk a little bit with Jonas and Darek about our current stuff. All right?
Okay. Sure.
Okay. Yeah. Perfect. See you soon, man.
Yeah.
Jonas.
Yes. Hello.
Hello. So how is it going, guys? Like a long time no talk here, right?
Yeah, it's been nearly 6 months, right? This is the last. No, it has been 6 months. Yeah.
It has been 6 months. Yeah. That's crazy.
Wow.
So where are you guys right now in the world? Exactly.
I am still in Australia right now for another month and a bit. Yeah.
So. Traveling, working?
Mostly traveling, some working, secret things, you know, just a little bit. Not too much. Nothing I can really expose right now. Yeah. But I'll be going to the States in a month or something to do some work.
Oh, that's awesome. And, where to exactly?
Seattle.
Seattle.
Yeah.
For how long?
Oh, just a few weeks, yeah.
Just a few weeks.
But again, I can't say anything about the project.
Of course. NDA, right?
Yes. But yeah, I think the nerds out there know what's in Seattle, so...
Yeah.
You know, bam. If you do research, you could probably figure it out. What about you guys, still in Poland?
Yeah, Poland.
Yeah, all the way good old Poland, man.
Like the old times. Like the beginnings. Freaking awesome. I mean, you know, like the more I come back here, the more I like it. Like, I like coming back here, but once I'm back after a few months, I want to get out to be back again. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, it's just this weird mix. I'm looking for some in-house stuff, I think, just to surround myself with the studio mindset just for a little bit. I mean, I want to switch it up a little bit, mix it up for some time.
I think it will be
doing
very
some personal stuff. I mean, yeah, it's not. I'll try my best, but I think around summer I will try to find something that is close enough. I think Europe still. Yeah. Not to go
guys,
too far.
If you guys haven't checked out Wojtek's website that he recently launched, you should definitely check it out. It's really nice.
Oh, you checked it out. Nice.
Yeah, of course, man. What do you think? Of course I checked it out. I just didn't say anything because I was jealous.
Ah, okay. I mean, you have a great website, too. Come on. Thanks, dude.
No, I think it was it's really good, so you'll definitely get some jobs through there soon.
Yeah, I remember learning from you, actually, because... If you guys don't know, Jonas is an organizing Nazi sometimes. Like, he wants to have everything intact and in place. And I remember when we were building the website, there was a lot of mess that we were doing with Darek together that Jonas just stepped in and said, no, just move this here, and, you know, it was all organized. So I was actually learning a lot about... I mean, that's the way you work, too. So that was pretty useful to see all around. Yeah, right. Yeah,
it is
right.
Important to be a Nazi sometimes, yes.
Yeah. About certain things. I mean, you don't want to say this, but I mean... so, Darek, what about you? I saw your Witcher cover recently. That was fucking amazing, man.
Oh, thanks, man.
I'm excited for the expansion, so... seeing your work?
Yeah, I'm pretty interesting actually to see the game. I played the Witcher 3 lately a little bit to just get in the mood. And even though I'm not
to get in the mood, yeah, of course.
Yeah, even though I'm not, you know, I'm not a regular player. I don't really like play games too much, but I kind of like, enjoyed it. And yeah, this work was actually fun. It was like a teamwork as well, so it was pretty cool.
So you were touching up renders and stuff, right, for promotional stuff? They send you the render and then you touch it up and.
Can you show the sketches, Darek?
Actually, not really. It is of course online, but I was asked actually to put it down because actually it's I posted the sketches along with the cover on ArtStation, and after 40 minutes I got a call.
Wow.
So actually I was asked to put it down because I wasn't actually aware that I shouldn't post those. So I put it down, but you know, Witcher is huge brand and it spread around the world pretty fast. And the sketches are just going till this day, and there were articles about it. And I had to, you know, I had to ask them to put it down, but it didn't work, and it spread anyway. So if you want, you can find it online. And
that's a valuable lesson, I think, for everyone to be careful with that kind of stuff.
Even if you are, you know, experienced, and if you are trying to know everything that everything is perfect and clean with your client, sometimes you still it has still happened that you make some mistake. You know?
What question is that? Interesting. Yeah.
Oh, talking about the Witcher cover that I did lately with the team from CD Projekt.
Oh,
and,
okay.
I wasn't actually allowed to post the sketches that leaked. And after 40 minutes that I posted them, I just deleted them after I was asked to do it, but people already downloaded them. And there were like plenty of articles about alternative covers for Witcher.
I guess it was because of the story clues.
I know. Yeah, it's, you know, I'm not fucking game player, so how should I know?
Yeah, Papa didn't know. Give him a break.
Yeah. But
okay.
All is good now. So.
Yeah, so I think the best thing to do is when you have a work that, like when a movie comes out, I always check with my art director or someone.
I spoke to Maciej lately about movies. Yeah. He always waits till the movie is out, and 1 month later he starts posting the concepts. So
but even then, man, like for example with Batman vs. Superman that recently came out, I contacted them to say, like, hey, can I release some stuff? And they're like, yeah, actually, you can release this stuff, but you can't release this stuff. And I didn't know why. And it's just because, well, one of the characters, Doomsday, changed so much in design between my concept and the movie that came out. They didn't want to release that work because the character wasn't representative of the movie. And, like, studios are really, you know, tricky about this kind of stuff. But then I was allowed to.
Sometimes they want to keep the old ideas for further, you know, so they can evolve it into new designs. It was the same with Assassin's Creed, basically.
Well, based on my experience, that many times my just like concept development work, they won't see the light of the day because as what Jonas say, the design has changed so much. By the time they come out, if it looks better than the actual one in the movie, it cost them a lot of trouble, you know? The fans will be furious.
Wow. Yeah, that's usually kind of the thing that you can think about. It's like, is this representative of the final product? If it's not, it's just going to confuse a lot of people and create all these, oh, what if stories, and, you know, like, could have been better, and, you know, so they don't want to avoid advertising.
Yeah.
All right, guys, let's move to the demo part. Stanley, hope you're...
Yeah.
Rest that a little bit. Ready?
Mm-hmm. Yep. So what do you like me to draw? Sketch or paint?
I guess it's not a question to us. I guess there are almost 500 people watching us now. Let's ask them. Let's wait a little bit. What guys do you want to see? A sketch or a painting? Or what kind of demo do you want? Stanley, you can take a look at the chat and see... what people...
No, once I started asking people for suggestions, your chat room will crash. Yeah.
Yeah, let's
it's
wait
crazy,
for
man. Yeah.
Maybe something level-related. Maybe you can draw pepper on a boar.
No, It's actually the chat starts to blow up actually now. So
ping. Everybody say ping. Okay, I'll sketch a little bit and ping. All right.
Okay. Awesome. Okay,
perfect.
Okay. And if you don't asking the questions in the meantime.
In the meantime. Yeah.
I can try to answer them. Yeah.
Can actually, if you're more comfortable with maybe explaining a little bit what you are doing, that will be priceless actually. Yeah. So once you feel like you want a little bit of silence to draw, let us know. Okay.
Yeah. No, it's okay. You guys can keep talking. I can keep answering if you can just let me go what questions. Yeah.
Sure.
That's a good thing about teachers. Teachers are very good at this.
Okay. I'm learning. I'm still because when I started talking, I draw really slowly. Yeah. Because I like to talk more than I draw. No.
Talking is true passion. There you go.
I'm already seeing some interesting behavior that I've seen with a couple of artists is the Control-Z brushstroke approach, where you are very specific about your brushstroke, and if you don't like it, you erase it straight away.
All right. Yeah, I like my sketch to be a bit cleaner, so and I like to take advantage of the Control-Z. This is basically a time travel options for me to actually go back. So, I love that. Yeah. I guess in my line of trade, or at least in what I'm doing to most of my clients, they prefer my precision in my line works. Especially working with comic clients like DC and stuff, they really enjoy the clarity of the art rather than something brushy. Yeah, I mean, personally, I like something more abstract, more brushy stuff, like my Daenerys that I did for Game of Thrones. Those stuff I love, but seems like my clients don't really care. Yeah, they like something more precise.
So does it happen that you doodle around with the brush strokes and then you try to find some idea within it? Or because you told us that you like to have the idea in your mind before you actually put it on the
correct canvas. So yep, that's right. I don't actually explore a lot. I mean, I won't say that I know 100% what exactly I'm getting, but I would say about 70%. So the 30% is basically for me to play around with options, how to stylize it. Usually when I draw character artworks, I treat it very much like a stock photo. So I take a nice stock photograph, and then eventually I choose how to stylize it, how to push it further with different color options. Yeah.
Okay.
So I have a question that is a little bit unrelated to the technical part, but I think it's what I noticed when looking at your activity online is that you are great at managing your fan base and keeping it excited about the stuff you're creating and providing a lot of cool stuff for your communities. So how do you manage to do this and where do you get ideas from? And what would be advices for people that want to have similar following to yours?
Yeah, the important thing about building a fan base is that you don't try too hard to build a fan base by accommodating to what your fans like. To me, I always hold true to that thinking, which means that I just draw whatever I like. The reason why people follow me is because I do what I like. So I will not like, oh, because of now I'm afraid of losing some fans, so I need to make sure that I draw what they like to see. Usually I don't do that, and that's number one. Secondly, I like to keep myself on that authentic and as transparent as possible. I try not to separate my personal life and my artist's life too much. I mean, I like to share with them the photo that I take with my kids and how I teach my kid to draw. Those are just part of me that make me who I am today. So I like to do that. And I like to make sure that when I interact with my fans, I can't answer all of their questions. That's impossible. But I would like to be as true as possible. I will not patronize them much. If I don't have anything to say, I would not say it. But when I say it, I really mean it. Yeah.
So what would be the advice that you could give to people that have art fundamentals intact, have cool ideas, but don't exactly know how to market themselves? Are there any things you did that helped you a lot? Any social media that worked better than others? And any behaviors that you noticed there that were beneficial?
Well, I think it's really important that when you create something that you need to go viral, which means that it must be shareable to people in order to maximize the eyeballs. So it can be something that is trending recently, or it can be something that make people smile. Usually lighter artworks, something that more friendly to look at, get to have more eyeballs rather than something that is too dark, too gloomy, too bloody and stuff. Yeah. I don't mean those artworks are wrong. It's just that you appeal to a very different kind of audience. Especially you talk about general public that you really need to do something that is really relevant to them and they can relate to. Or something that they would like to put it on their wall. I mean, I'm not sure if I should say that. Yeah, but for example, you look at Craig Mullin's art. It's awesome. It's deeply appreciated by artists like us. He's like a god to many of us. But at the same time, how often do you see your mom actually put up a piece of that kind of artwork in the living room? No, they don't. Doesn't mean that those are the bad. It's just that they are not easily relatable to general public.
Yeah. You have to have some sort of sensibility to appreciate the way he paints, right? So it's the specific audience that he...
Correct.
There is this thing that... So for some artists, so you are true to yourself creating your art, right? And it happens to be really attractive and universal. So you're lucky, so to speak. I'm not sure if I can tell it. Yeah, because you can be true to yourself and you can draw and paint stuff that a lot of people love at the same time. So it's a good combination. So what if I draw stuff that is less popular, I draw it nicely, so then I should find an audience, but it will be probably a little bit harder to actually find it. So yeah, so there are these different types of...
I always believe that not all artists want to be celebrities. Yeah. Some artists like to be, for example, production artists, like concept artists, they like to be involved with a bigger picture, a big project, instead of selling their work as it is. So I make this analogy like how you run a restaurant. Not everybody wants to be a McDonald's, you know. Some people want to just open a small cafe around the corner of their neighborhood, just serve nice bread and cakes for the friends. I mean, art to me is the same way. There's many different paths. Most important is that do you enjoy what you're doing? Yeah,
that's true.
So you always came up with that kind of thinking of, you know, you were working and doing the stuff that you loved, and you got and acquired the clients by that way, or you just, when you were in the beginnings, you tried to reach out to them on your own, or you just painted and then they came in and asked you for work, and that's how it all started with your, you know, professional works and commissions.
I would say that
because following not always equal the number of work, right?
Yes, that's right. Mm. And followers sometimes means very little. I mean, like, exactly. I would like to have quality followers rather than numbers. Yeah.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah.
So that was the way that you acquired your client base, right?
Yeah, I always believe that in order to have a good, in order to work with my client on a longer term, I need to make sure that my client become my friends. That to me is important. You see, in today's world, there's so many new artists coming up every day.
Yeah.
And someone got to paint better, faster, and cheaper than you. That's for sure.
Yeah.
And how are you going to stay competitive in this industry? Is to make sure that your people choose to work with you, no longer choose to work with you logically. They choose to work with you emotionally. That means like, it's like when you buy branded stuff, branded handbags and stuff, you're no longer looking at it from the logical point of view because they are freaking expensive. But you like to pay that kind of money because it just emotionally speaks to you. You're just like a fan, no?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So if you can work with a client that gives you that kind of mindset that is like, they're like your fans, they no longer consider you cheap or expensive based on how fast you work, how realistic you render. They just choose to work with you because you are who you are.
Yeah, I think to me, I'm happy to hear it, actually.
Yeah, so that's a brand building kind of approach, yeah.
Yeah, definitely. Very good tip, I guess.
So being yourself and...
Yeah, and because I think sometimes people
it's not always about the skill of drawing or painting or concepting itself. It's the way you can contribute by your with your personality and with your ideas to a certain project.
It starts with the techniques and your skills, but it ends up with something that who you are and, you know, how do you deal with them? Because you can be just the guy that do the work and quit, right? Or you can just keep in touch with them, and you have that feel that you can always rely on them if you are in trouble or whatever, and vice versa. So
I think it's very important to believe in your clients and then really do the best for them. When I work with company like Capcom, especially recently with Street Fighter V, it's a very interesting talk we have with them, because they don't really have a lot of budget for my art. In fact, they can't really afford what I'm doing. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, I love Street Fighter V so much, I just want to be part of the game, basically. So what I did was that I just draw them my version of Ryu and Ken. It's in black and white. I'm not sure if you've seen it. My Ryu and Ken. And then I just send to them, say, you can use that for free.
Mm-hmm.
Because I just love Street Fighter and love you guys. So although you cannot afford paying me, I just give it to you to use it wherever you like. And I think that kind of gesture really inspired my clients and make them work harder to eventually find a budget to work with me. Yeah.
Mm. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Mm. That's really good. That's really good to hear.
Yeah. I think eventually, look at the stuff that I drew. I drew so many fan art, I can't even count. But there's always one truth I always hold on to, is that I would never draw something that is exactly like the original. Yeah, I always like to put my own spin into it and always like to stay true to the original design intent of the character, which means that you can never see me draw a slutty Wonder Woman, never, because that's not who she is. Mm-hmm. And I would never do that. And
so you don't change the character, you stay true to the character, but give it your own, like the way you see her, right, artistically.
And that's right. So in that sense, it inspire my client and make them want to work with me more. Yeah.
Yeah. Great.
But that's me, yeah.
So now we are working on values, and do you intend this sketch to be in color in the final, or you want it to be black and white at the end?
Sometimes I do. Usually I have that decided before I started drawing. For example, when I do my Street Fighter artworks, they are basically black and white. So I just stick with black and white and just play with the values a lot more. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. But in any case, if I want to colorize them, I can still do that. In fact, I have a YouTube tutorial just to talk about that. Yeah.
So you are also live streaming constantly, right? And yes, you have your own YouTube channel, and we'll make sure to link it in the description to this video, or you will be able to find it on the right in the cards that we will redirect there. You have a lot of tutorials there too, right? A lot of.
I would say that actually tutorial, just like my drawings, and then you just record my process. It's not exactly a show and tell kind of tutorial. Yeah.
Is there any? Are there any online art tutorials you created that people that are watching our session today can follow? Or is there just a content that is without commentary?
Sometimes I do. When I do a live stream for a more specific kind of tutorial, I would say that it's a tutorial. Then I would talk a lot more about the technique and stuff. But most of the time when I do my live stream, it's just to draw whatever I need to work on at the moment. Sometimes commercial stuff. Sometimes just personal artworks, yeah.
Okay, perfect. So there is the creation part, right? The stuff you're doing right now, losing yourself in a moment and creating whatever your mind brings you. But I also can see that the big part of you is actually teaching. Like, do you have a lot of passion towards it too?
Yes, I love teaching. Yeah.
Yeah, so how fast have you noticed that in your career that you like to, what would you say is the quality of yourself that enables you to understand people that are learning? And what do you think, how does it work? Because not a lot of artists are actually able to transfer their knowledge so easily as you're doing.
Yeah.
So.
I think it's because I walked through the same path without any mentors, without anybody guiding me. So I learned the hard way. I make a lot of mistakes, and those mistakes can be a good case study for my students. Yeah.
Okay, so we can see the same mistakes, and you can see similar paths, and you just have more answers, and you can see
I think naturally I'm a person who like to question things a lot, so I will not just take things for granted. I need to know the root of the issues. I like to know why certain things happen that way, like when I paint something, why it had to be done this way. And because of that, it's easier for me to translate those knowledge to my students, because I ask myself a lot of questions, naturally. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Let me bring up some more technical questions. How do you choose your color scheme and lighting for your artworks? I guess it depends, right? But in general, maybe some tips you can give on color palette and lighting in general.
General, if you find that color is hard for you to manage, try to reduce the use of colors. Just have dominating colors. For example, 70% of the colors dominating, for example, blue, greenish blue, reddish, purplish blue, and then have 30% of whatever color that is remaining. I think to me that will help to control your palette. But your color sense is pretty much based on your aesthetic choice. Means like you need to understand your aesthetics, which is the hardest to teach, like what makes something look good to you. So you need to constantly question yourself, why would you do this? Why would you do that? Why would you buy this piece of t-shirt? What make this or this dress? What make it's so cool that you would like to set apart your money for it. And with that, you start to understand your personal aesthetic sense, and eventually you can translate that back to your artworks. Yeah.
Yeah, so, because Dark, go ahead.
Yeah, okay, maybe you can go ahead because I have another question.
Okay, I was just about to talk about color because it's such a huge topic that you can explore in many, many different ways. You have to actually get in there with some sort of identity and a goal, I guess, artistic sense that you can trust and that can guide you towards. Because there are a lot of things that I wouldn't imagine would work. If someone would example that would tell me that, for example, describe to me a Craig Mullins or Ashley Wood painting in words. Mm-hmm. Like what colors he used here and in the shadows, in the midtones, and so on, I would say it would never freaking work. But suddenly I can see the painting and it's just gorgeous. And how the hell did it happen, right? And it just proves to me that everything is possible in terms of playing around with colors. And it just grows from a really deep understanding of how the real lighting works and how our brain perceives what it perceives. And you know, some people focuses on minimizing, simplifying, and some people break down colors into vibrations and you know, opposing colors that creates other ones. There are tons of ways to play around with it, and actually I love this subject so much.
Actually it's important that on a daily basis that you archive those color palette that you really like, mainly from photography, that you can make use of them in your daily work. Yeah, I think one of the very good hobby that artists like us can have is really photography. Yeah, because the fundamental is pretty much the same. You're presenting an idea within a rectangle box, and that's the same for photography. And you have to train you up for the sensibility of perspective, lighting, contrast, compositions. And nowadays, with your phone camera with you, I mean, not as efficient, but at least you have a phone camera with you, you can actually do a lot of studies with that.
Yeah, I was talking with my friend recently, Matthias, and he is a fan of doing a lot of exercises and studying a lot. He's a hard worker. And he found this application called Cameringo on Android, I think, and it's a great sketching app, but with photos, so you can do a nice black and white photos with it, because it's simplifying a lot of values and so on, so it looks a little bit more graphical, so you can see more clear the composition you're doing and play around with how the world looks around you and find cool frames around you and note these ideas and notice what types of, you know, rhythms and value schemes captures you. So sketching, but with photography, is just awesome. I tried it myself, and nowadays having just a phone in your pocket, it has never been easier, really.
Right? Exactly. Yeah, it's true. Mm. And aesthetic is not something that I can just tell you what looks good. You need to believe that, and you need to accept that that's really looking good to you. And that's something that is a self-discovery. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. There's this taste thing that we all have.
That's right.
So there's skill in drawing, proficiency in painting, being fast, knowing your anatomy and stuff. But also, there is a taste. And how do you think you develop your, I can call it design sensibility, I think, design sense and taste? How do you nurture this quality?
Yeah, again, I think the simplest way to put it is that I always question why I choose certain things. What makes me do certain things? And I need to understand why I find this appealing, or even just from the faces. Like, why I choose to like this girl's face more than the other celebrity. What makes this face so unique to me? And I try to replicate that in my work. It's a lot of self-evaluation, ongoing process, every now and then. Yeah.
That's really interesting and very true, because a lot of people, that when they see something and like it, they just like it and it just flies away immediately.
It's like how when you show a piece of work to your parents, it's like they would just say, "Oh, it's nice," or "It looks weird," but that's all they can say. But us as artists, we are responsible to understand why it looks good and what makes it work. I think that to me is important. Yeah.
Yeah, that's very true. And finding these really specific qualities that make it appeal to you gives you the tools, I think, to actually use it later. Like you and I think this is how the style is developed, so to speak. So you deconstruct what you see around you.
Style is basically exaggeration of reality, and every style has a formula. So in order to get that, you need to understand the formula. It's like a recipe, you know? It's like a cooking recipe. You need to find way to exaggerate reality by taking something or adding something in order to make it work. Yeah.
Yeah, there you go.
There's a question that's not related to this technical side. It's a little bit more about what we were talking previously with marketing yourself and so on.
Yep.
And if you have a group of people who want to set up a small studio, what would be your advice for it? How do you manage to keep them, you know, in a group? How do you keep it all, you know, together and, you know, all logistic stuff?
My advice, don't do it. To be honest, setting up a studio is very easy. You find a space, rent a space, and that's it. But how to keep it going, to me, is the most important part of it. And many times, don't do it because, oh, I have a bunch of friends. We are very passionate. Let's do it, man.
Yeah.
It sounds easy, but when it comes to the daily grind and when it comes to the overhead, who pay the bills, eventually all this reality will come in. Yeah.
Exactly.
So to me, that if you want to open up studio, make sure you have a unique vision and a unified vision that everybody can contribute to the single vision. If you can't, if you just want to have fun together, you don't need to set up a company. Yeah.
Yeah, you need to become confident with it, right?
Yeah, and many of us, at least especially for myself, I think I'm a lousy businessman. I don't think I can manage business. I can only draw. So when I don't look at numbers, because numbers drive me crazy. So so you need someone you can rely on to look at that part of the business.
Mm. Yeah, it can be part of the team, right? Because you don't regret it that you have it right now, right?
Yes, of course.
Mm. Yeah, and you're touching a really good point here. I think as artists have to remember that still what we do is art, not business, so to speak. And it's being a freelancer involves a lot of paperwork, a lot of managing stuff, a lot of self-promotion, and we tend to like certain things more and less. For example, I like self-promotion side, but I don't necessarily like the business side of things, like, you know, managing taxes, invoices, and all sorts of things. No one likes it, right? But actually, for a long time, I tried to do it all myself, and I was constantly making mistakes, and suddenly I discovered, hey, I don't have to be perfect in anything. In everything, I can trust, right? I can give the people that love to do it.
Provided you can trust them, because I always say that when you're first started, when you are not earning much, it's very easy to work with each other. The problem usually come when you start making money.
When the money comes in.
Yeah, then people will start to wait whether you put in enough effort that you deserve more or less. I mean, to me, that become very realistic. And sometimes you spoil your friendship.
Yeah, that's true.
Exactly, yeah. And it's much easier when you are doing, even when you are managing all the stuff, all the logistic on your own, when you are alone, actually, rather than you have a team surrounding you or people working with you.
Yeah, that's true.
So, Stanley, what do you think about this recent trend of, we had Gumroads and now I guess we have Patreon going on. So what do you think about this this trend of, do you think it's good or do you think it's bad? What do you think about this?
Yeah, I think that because of some success story of seeing people making tons of money, now everybody has a Patreon. I would say that Patreon is a way to monetize your fan base, but it should not be a place for you to build your fan base. To me, that's quite obvious. And it's not easy, you know, unless you're like Sakimi-chan, that you actually earn tons of money on it. If you're first starting out, you are talking about earning $10, $50 a month, and you have to churn out the amount of content for those people who subscribe to your Patreon. And how long can you sustain that kind of life?
Yeah, that's true. So you would rather go there once you have a big following and big enough that can actually support you? And you actually have to have some sort of a catching product that will be sellable. So yeah, I guess you have to be a good teacher too in order to create this sort of content.
Good teacher and good content, I guess.
Yeah,
To me, Patreon is such a way. I mean, one thing I don't really like Patreon is that artists on Patreon become a toy for the fans. Means like because of you have to maintain the subscription. Now you have to draw whatever that your fans ask you to do it because they pay for it, you know. So you become a toy for your fans, which I personally don't really like. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And honestly, how many people actually learn from the Patreon? Some yes, some no. But I would say most of the time they're just flapping materials for you to just be happy that your favorite character is being drawn by someone. And that's I mean, they provide Photoshop files, layers, videos, but do you actually learn from it? I don't know, because I asked so many of my students who has a Patreon subscription for some of these artists, they don't really learn shit. They just like the fact that they got something from this person. Yeah,
and sometimes it's not even that. Sometimes it's just supporting the person we admire as an artist, for example. Yeah, sometimes it's just this. And so, like, I'm supporting a couple of people on Patreon too, but I don't really have time to look at the contents. From time to time, I do look at it, but I'm not doing it for the content. I'm doing it more for, like, thumbs up, I love the stuff you're doing, keep it going, right? Because I know that's their main.
Yeah, to me, that's interesting that how our world has changed. Now, more people has a chance to make a living with different way, including Patreon. To me, it's still eventually still a good thing. I mean, it doesn't mean that I won't be on Patreon, but if I'm on Patreon, I'll use it very differently. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We can see a trend that you were talking about that people tend to not have a strong identity there, but just bend towards their audiences more.
Yeah. I mean, honestly, that many of the Patreon artists, they draw fan art and stuff, like what I usually do. But I won't say all, but many of them choose to, how should I put that? Choose to brutalize the character. or portray the character in a different light that from the original intent of the designer. So to me, I don't like the idea.
Yeah. It's kind of unhealthy, so to speak. It just feeds the audience that I wouldn't want to have, I guess.
I think my idea is simple. If you're going to make money off someone else's property, the least you can do is to be truthful to the character that you draw. I mean, that's a basic. Yeah.
That's very true. Yeah. So you have to stick to.
But that's for me.
It's a different character, right? If it's a different character, once you change it, it just has the same skin and.
Yeah.
Packaging, but different context and different design in some parts. But then it's,
But then again, it's really up to the individual artist to make that decision because their own journey, their own path, I can't really criticize them as long as they find that's what they want to be. You know what I'm saying? Yeah.
Yeah, that's true. Mm. Okay, we have some more questions. What was the harshest critique you received during your career, and was it helpful?
I'm a pretty positive person. I don't remember those shitty stuff in my life. But I would say that until today, I still receive some of these nasty comments about my art and stuff. Usually, people will talk about. Oh, you always draw the same thing. Why don't you draw something different? Why don't you do this? Why don't you do that? I think that become a part of the daily routine of things that I get on a daily basis. I think I want to take this opportunity to actually say something about that. You see, one day you pass by a restaurant and you look at the menu. You don't like it. For example, you go to McDonald's. You will not step into McDonald's and ask the McDonald's manager and say, why do you only sell burgers? Why can't you sell fried rice? Why can't you sell noodles? Yeah. You don't do that. If you don't like the food, you walk away and choose something that you like. But many times, artists being exposed to such attack, like, oh, people come to you and say, why don't you do this? Oh, you draw too many girls. Why don't you draw some guys? Now you draw some guys. Why don't you draw some monsters? Why don't you do environment, mechanical designs, like stuff like that? It's good for you. It's for your own journey. It's for your good. It's good for you as an artist. I mean, like, to me, this is totally strange, right? You don't walk into people's house and comment on their decorations or interior designs, just like that. So I would say that people need to be more careful and don't take it too offensive and towards comments like that, because it's happened to everyone, especially more high-level people.
Great.
I'll say that you need to understand at the end of the day, artists like us all, we have our own unique design language, our own artistic language to communicate our art to the world, and it's a personal choice. It's just like you won't go into an Apple shop and look around Apple products and say, why can't you do something like Samsung? Why can't you do something like Sony? You don't do that. Because every one of us has our own unique vision and unique design language, and people need to understand that. Yeah. And together, as a community, we contribute to the diversity of art, but not individual, try to satisfy every bit of your art needs. That's what I'm trying to say. Yeah.
So, yeah, you're going to, let's say, an Apple store, for an Apple product, right? So
this is
what they're successful about, and I guess any other big brand, that if you're stepping into some sort of shop, let's say Samsung store, you're getting there for a Samsung product. So here it's the same, right?
Exactly.
So you know what you're getting, basically. If an artist creates environments and he's great at it, but he's still loves to explore, so to speak, and he builds his audience around that, I guess it's fair to say that people that will come back and will follow him and will find his work will keep coming back, not for portraits, but for environment work, right? So they're, Yeah, I guess it's a really simple and basic idea that gets lost when the term artist is being involved, because sometimes people just don't get... I mean, I guess it's just that understanding a personal agenda is hard.
Yeah, it's hard on the internet.
Not even in art, you know, everywhere, so... in any field, really. So you're getting you're working super fast. So now it's, I think, around.
Am I?
20 minutes, I guess. And the black and white looks really beautiful. So do you feel you want to go further with it, or you feel like it's done for now, or?
If you can have question for me, I can keep drawing. I have no intention to end anytime soon.
Darek, do we have any other questions that you can see?
Yeah, I can have a look, actually.
Okay. Would you consider creating some sort of a storytelling-driven medium, such as comic or a graphic novel, or have you thought about doing something like that?
Yeah, a few years ago, DC contacted me to do a standalone comic for Batman. And it may be a dream come true for many people, but for me, I'm just not that kind of artist I would like to be. The problem is that it's not that I am afraid that I don't do a good job. The problem is that I'm afraid I do a good job.
Yeah, because once you do it,
once you started that thing going, and then more similar job will come to my way, and I don't like that, so I rather don't do it, because I just don't have a strong desire to tell a story, like in a comic book way. So that's basically who I am. Yeah, I prefer not to do that. Yeah.
So you think about creating more original designs and evolve it instead of just, as you said, doing some stories. So you have a plan for doing new characters or, you know, new designs for your characters?
To me, I just, honestly, I'm just a simple person. I just like to draw. I just like to draw whatever I feel inspired at the time, and people pay money for it. Just all I want to do.
That's super simple. Yeah. Stanley, do you think we can go a little bit towards color and maybe how you work from black and white to color?
Sure.
Yeah, I just noticed a lot of people asked the question in the chat about.
Yeah, actually, as I say, I have a YouTube tutorial to show you exactly step by step how do I do it. But for the sake of this level up, I will do it for you.
That's awesome.
Thank you.
That's perfect. I bet people will appreciate it. Awesome.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, usually when you convert a black and white into color, I choose not to do it after I finish a value painting 100%. So something at this stage is about 20-30%, to me, is a good chance for me to convert into color. Yeah. Doesn't mean it cannot be done in 100% grayscale. It's just that you need to do a lot more fine-tuning later on. But if you colorize it earlier, like at this stage, then you have a more chance to play around with stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So now I have a black and white art, which now I'm in Photoshop. So now I just duplicate it. And then I'm not sure if I can share the full screen. I'm not sure it will lag. Let me try. I'm working on a 27-inch iMac Retina, so it may lag a little bit.
In the meantime, there is a question regarding doing fan art, and people are asking why so many people are doing it. Because I think every of us did it at some point, and why it's so important for artists to do fan art instead of just building their own stuff.
Yep, you see, not many one of us always have a great idea to begin with. Sometimes you have an existing idea that people are already established. Mm-hmm. It means the world idea, the world concept is already done, and you just make use of that, and that sometimes it's easier, so that you can just focus on the aesthetic part of it, or the rendering part of it, or just the style of it. But I would always say that fan art comes into two ways. One is a way for you to say thank you to someone that you love, the creator.
Yeah.
Yes, and the other way is to showcase what you can do to make a difference to that idea. So many times I work with clients from DC, especially for DZ, I worked with DC officially. Before I worked with them officially, I was drawing fan art for Batman. Mm-hmm. And after I worked with them, I'm still drawing Batman. And that's no different from me doing a fan art and now working officially with them. The only difference is that now I get paid.
Yeah.
And that's it. So the idea of making fan art unique to you, not only because of the famous character, but because how you portray the character in your unique vision that make this image unique. To me, that's important. Yeah. Yeah. So, for example, I mean, it's a very simple logic. If one day you want to be a cover artist for Avengers, what is the best way to show Marvels that you can draw Avengers?
Just draw it.
Draw Avengers, right?
Yeah.
So if you want to work on the next Warcraft, and how do you show Blizzard that you can do Warcraft? You just show them Warcraft stuff. It's really that simple. Yeah.
It's already
I think it's a great promotional tool for people, actually. I was about to add, because I'm not sure if people do it intentionally, as in, you know, I'm going to try to get out there by doing fan art. But it's definitely sure that if you're a good artist and you do, you know, some character that you thought of yourself, and then you do some piece of, Mononoke Hime or something, you're going to get thousands of, you know, likes and comments and shares on the Mononoke piece because it's a very popular content. So it's definitely a good... You know, I'm not saying that you should just do it with that in mind, but I think there's a huge promotional value in doing
it's
fan
smart
art.
Move, yeah.
Yeah, it's definitely smart if you can, you know. And I've seen artists who rely heavily on it, and it works, you know. It works by just picking stuff that's currently trending. And it's more of a business move than it is an artistic one a lot of times.
Because you
just pick whatever.
Yeah.
It's popular at the time, you know, you pick Game of Thrones or something like that, and you know, like, you know when these things are trending and which time to do these kind of things. I actually got the job on Final Fantasy because I did a fan art, only there was a 3-year gap. But still, I never thought afterwards they would go like, oh yeah, we saw this actually a couple of years ago, and you know, you clearly understand this and this, so that's why we reached out to you.
Yeah, so, but you know, at the same time, it's a great promotional material, and it can land you a job, but it has to be honest, right? So the fan art you're doing has to be you have to love it, right? You have to love it to actually.
Yeah, you have
it.
To put
not
your own sense
for the, sake of the promotion it gives you, but for the sake of the love. Right?
I don't know. I guess, you know, ideally yes, but I'm not sure if this is how the reality works, to be honest. It does for a lot of people, but I think now that it's kind of known that this works, I'm sure that people will do it for the sake of doing it. I'm not saying that whatever they choose, they don't love.
Yeah, people will be doing, but you have to be noticeable by something. Even if you are doing, you know, another 80-80 theme, and there are doing thousands of people, and you put something that attracts the viewer more than them, it's that your win situation, right? Because other 1,000 people did it and they didn't actually were noticed, you know? So in the same time, you can just do fan art and still evolve your own project.
Also, I can tell when the fan art is drawn for the sake of popularity and when the fan art is actually growing out of a personal interest of the artist.
Yeah,
it's actually
easy to see if it's cheap.
Yeah, easy to see, and it's usually way better than the art created for the sake of likes or
of course.
I don't know. Jonas, I'm interested in hearing what do you think? Jonas?
Me?
Oh. Yeah.
I don't fully agree. Have you seen art that you know is just for the sake of popularity? Like, can you think of something? You don't have to say who or what, but can you think of something right now? An example in your head?
Yeah.
Because honestly, I think it just comes down to your skill, you know? Like, there's a like, if you go on DeviantArt, there are thousands of fan arts of all kinds of stuff, you know, mostly anime, I would say. Like, if you type, I don't know, Naruto fan art, you'll probably find, you know, a million submissions. But obviously, you still need a certain level of skill level to be noticed with any type of fan art.
Yeah, sometimes the idea but is not enough. If
you're technically good enough, it doesn't really matter what the intent is, you know. It's just, it just works, and it's
going
to help you.
Okay, that's a good point. That's a good point. It's actually just visual, right? Just visual. The final product is just visual. So there's nothing more to it. But at the
and
same
I don't
time,
think there's anything wrong with it if that's your intention.
Yeah, I mean,
from an idealistic point of view, maybe it's not as flattering as you might want, you know, for the artists. But ultimately, it's also a business, and if that's your approach, then why not, you know? And if you happen to love it, even better.
At the same time, it can work. Let's say you don't like the theme of, I don't know, you don't like Batman, but Batman is trending, so you draw Batman. And then you get a job opportunity because you did it so good, so nicely, your skill is so high that actually, let's say, somebody turns in and says, hey, I'm DC and I want you to draw this, this, and this, Batman involved, but you hate a fucking Batman. So what do you
do? Yeah, well, then you shot yourself in the foot, I guess.
I think it's just the attitude of being professional, because you're not always jumping into the project that you are specifically aiming for, and you are taking it the job or not. You have a choice, and if you choose it, you have to show that you're professional and do it good, right?
I think most people will be happiest by getting somewhere following their own ideas and their own things. Actually, I think Dan Luisi is a good example, because
yeah, it's definitely a good example.
He did a lot of stuff for, I'm not sure if it was Marvel or DC, but also comic-related stuff. And at some point he was like, well, I'm getting these jobs because I'm able to render these pre-existing characters in a, you know, the way that pleases them. But actually, mm-hmm. I want to do my own stuff. And, you know, if you keep doing that, it's kind of like actors who are being typecast, you know? Jim Carrey is always playing a funny retard for some reason, you know, like kind of like goofy, weird guy. But actually, he's a very skillful actor, but he's being typecast because probably from early in his career, that's what he did, and people liked him, and then they kept giving you that job. Yeah. But this gives you a very small space of opportunity in terms of your own creative development as a person. So that's where I think it can backfire if you rely too heavily on this, because you will get jobs doing what you're doing. That's just the way it works. So if you're doing your own stuff that you really love, that comes out of your head and your mind, and people hire you for that, I think ultimately you will be the happiest, because then you will literally get paid to do whatever you want and you come up with, rather than working with pre-existing stuff and just kind of like, you know,
yeah,
using a branded thing that's already there.
Yeah.
Okay, Stanley, let's talk about the coloring technique you were about to talk about, but we got a little bit sidetracked, so let's get back to it.
Yeah, usually what happens is that in the earlier stage, when you do a black and white stuff, many people just do a, let me go back to grayscale, that people just start colorizing it based at this stage. And because of the gray tone that you have, that when you overlay colors on it, the colors will turn muddy. Mm. So what I usually like to do is that I will actually do a simple gradient mapping. So basically a gradient mapping to just map a simple tone on it. Mm. Example, and I can control how I want to perceive, because once the color mix into the gray, the value start to change. Then you need to make a decision at this bottom how to actually grayscale, how to actually put some base color inside here. So I use a gradient map, which you can see here, and once I get that in, then now I can have a base for me to start colorizing on top of that. Yeah. Mm. So this is a simple process for me to remove the muddy colors. Yeah. Mm. Once that's done, when I overlay colors, when I double click the layer, and basically what I did is this. This is without any edits. Just as it is, set it in color mode, and there's something that you will get when you overlay colors on it. But usually I will do that, and I will just pull out this cursor to control how much of this colorizing layer affecting the underneath layer. Mm. With that, I can control, but holding the alternate key or the option key to drag it out so that some of this value is not blended as much. Mm. That reveals some of the base color that I set in the underneath layer, which is this layer. Yeah. And that, to me, it gives me a bit more natural colorization process. And then after this, I can paint on top of it. Mm.
Mm-hmm. So that's the stage when you actually go in and finalize the value stage together with color, right?
Now, this is really a rough color base for me to paint color on top of it. So from this point onward, I'll be painting colors instead of painting gray. Yeah.
Awesome. So,
so you should, I can show you some of the artworks that's done in this technique. Let me stop my screen share first. Actually, I don't have to stop my screen share.
Yeah, be careful with the NDA stuff. Sometimes it gets spilled.
I honestly don't really care. If it happens, it happens. Okay.
There you go.
Too bad. Yeah.
Okay. Boss approach.
Yeah. Mhm. Mhm. Yep. So let me just single out a few. Let's see. Yeah, for example, Elsa is done in this process. So it was first done in grayscale and eventually colorized. Yeah, something like this. It can go into something really, really vibrant. This is not too vibrant, but it was done in grayscale first and then this process. So many projects.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, and I hate that there are tons of them that can't be shown. Yeah. So artworks like this, it was done in grayscale, eventually colorized earlier, and then paint on top of it.
So how much time would you usually need for a portrait like to take it to this quality?
Usually about 6 hours, yeah.
Okay, that's great.
That's pretty fast actually.
Yeah. That's a cover quality, I'd say.
Hey Stanley, do you feel afraid sometimes to tell clients what the actual speed is that you can create something in? Because sometimes I feel like I should tell them that I work slower than I really do. Because
You totally should. Yeah. That's a true story. When I work with DC and I told them, I need 2 days to churn out this cover. And next time they talk to me, they'll give me 1 day.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. So I always say it takes longer than it's really needed. Yeah, it's just to protect yourself because they will take advantage of it. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think so too. It's like, oh wow, you can do this in a few hours, all right. And then there's an expectation, and then suddenly there's a piece that you can do in that time that takes 2 days because you gotta, I don't know, model some 3D stuff, and then you've just.
And the worst thing is that they will sit on it. They will sit on the project until the last day. They will come back to you and say, actually, I need it tomorrow. Yeah. It happens all the time. Yeah.
Yeah, be careful what you say, right? What you say with what your speed is, and not even to the clients themselves, but even online when you say, "Oh, quick 10-minute sketch," and you fucking upload like a crazy sci-fi city or something, and don't expect clients to come and give you a week for a speed painting, right?
I don't know anybody who does that. What are you talking about?
Right.
Exactly. Yeah, works smart, huh? Okay. Is there anything else that people like to ask?
Yeah. Let's see. How do you get? What would be the advice you would give to yourself? To your younger self now, if you would have a chance to speak to your younger version.
Play less games.
There you go. What are your favorite ones?
Katamari, actually. I'm not sure you know about this game. It's called Katamari Tetamasi. It's basically a little cute boy rolling a ball and rolling the entire world.
There you go. I don't know.
Oh, it's amazing. You guys really play this shit. It's really, really awesome. This is actually...
I know it. It's a PS2 game, right?
Yeah, it's a game that this little boy is just like rolling a ball and suck up the entire city and their planet. Yeah. So from a little paperclip all the way to the whole planet. Yeah. So freaking amazing. Yeah.
Ridiculous game, but yeah, it looks so crazy.
And the style is awesome.
I remember my friend playing it, and I was like, dude, what the hell? What the hell? I was copying. Mm-hmm. Can you repeat?
What's the point exactly of this game? I'm having a hard time.
The point is to get the ball to a certain size that is specified. Ah. For example, now this one is 15 cm. Your objective is to make it 10,000 kilometers.
Okay.
So you start sucking small things like the Legos and the paper clips, and all the way until to your house, to your town, to your city.
So it changes scale. Okay.
And then you suck up the entire world, then go to the universe and suck up all the planets. So, yeah. It's amazing.
Sounds like an LSD trip to me.
To me, that's creative.
It sounds very creative, yeah. Yeah.
Crazy stuff. I love how your palette can look limited, but at the same time vibrant and alive, so to speak. So it's not going really saturated anywhere, but at the same time it feels very lively, and it's really fun. I feel like you can control color really well. Like, I've seen your pieces when you're going really vibrant, but at the same time there are pieces that are really sensible in terms of vibrancy too.
I think it's when you turn the color up in terms of saturation, the color will start to go in their separate ways. So it takes more control for you to bring those color back together by sharing some common colors in between to bring them back together. But if you're talking about low saturation colors, naturally they come together much closer because of the saturation. So it's easier to blend them. Yeah.
That's a good question. How do you stop yourself from overdoing an artwork? And do you know when you reach the part in your artwork that can be classified as finished?
It's a very interesting question. There's two ways to define whether this image is finished. Number one, the deadline is now. You need to submit it, so it's finished.
Yeah.
If it's not because of the deadline, then you need to ask yourself that if I put another stroke on this image, does it make any more difference? If it doesn't make any difference, I will stop. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Because you can render until like
Render like crazy.
Every strand of hair is accounted for, but that would not be. To me, I would rather look at everything that come together as unity rather than chasing the detail game. I don't like the detail games. I don't like to render things up to the maximum. I like to give some room to breathe, to imagine, to let go. I like that.
That are in the place where it's the most focal, right? But it's
usually are
from portrait and the full scenery. Like you have, you know, the whole scene with a couple of characters, and it's quite different, I would say, than just portrait.
Yes, like, that's right.
Creating these expressive pieces tend to create some sort of a dialogue with your audience, actually, because sometimes when you're going looser with your strokes, I can see it in Darek's style, and I can see it in your looser sketches, that you can start creating a dialogue with your audience once there is more to imagine and there is more suggested stuff. So there is a place for them to actually
stories.
Yeah, exactly, to actually read your suggestions, not maybe exactly as you intended, but in a way that maybe different, and it sometimes it's on a micro level of like brush strokes, but sometimes it's on a bigger level, like bigger scale, like the brush stroke can be a building. So it's a really fun thing. I noticed that it creates more dialogue, and sometimes pieces that looser.
Yeah, sometimes it's a shame when you have to finish everything.
More response.
Yeah, I mean, many clients, they like to see everything rendered up. I mean, honestly, you talk about clients like Epibot, they like everything to be rendered up to micro level.
I remember doing that Witcher cover, and I had to put like every single hair on his chest just to make sure it looks photoreal.
Yes.
It's crazy.
There's no subjective details. They need actual details.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah,
it's fun. I guess that's a point of if the game is realistic.
Exactly.
It has to stay, like the promotional art that goes along with it has to actually match.
Yeah, they
the
have
content.
Some standard and you have to make it up to this standard. So
Yeah, I
don't mind, you know. It's a good
You don't mind painting chest hair.
No, definitely. You know,
yeah, just look down. You have some good reference.
Yeah, I know. I use my mirror, man, all the time.
Have you posed for this cover yourself?
Of course.
Like, come on, do some photos of Papa on the throne. I need some reference of a badass man.
Girl, do your job.
Oh, yeah. All right, so it looks like you are
I'm just adding the details and yeah, just keep going until you want me to stop. Yeah.
I guess we can touch a couple more questions, and being 2 hours in, we can start wrapping up shortly. Yeah, let's see if there are any other questions. Guys, it's the last minute question time, so before I will ask my final question, let's squeeze a couple more from the chat. So there is a.
And yes, I need to give away my art. So,
all right. Oh, okay. Yeah. So we still don't know what type of rule would there be to actually give them away, Stanley.
Okay, so basically, I ask a question. Whoever type it out fast will get it.
All right. So can you actually look at the chat and ask the question, and then there's a 1 minute delay, but. All right, let's try it.
Yeah, so the first person who type out the answer will get it. So, let's make it easy, all right, for the first one. Can anybody tell me what is my only formal education in my life?
Wikipedia.
The only formal education. What course is that?
Okay, let's wait. Or chat to catch up.
By the way, my students are not allowed to take part, all right?
Okay.
There you go. Waiting.
All right, so Aris got it.
Aris, all right, let's...
Okay. Aris, you can message me on my Facebook directly just to let me know that you are the one who answered that. Let me write down. Aris. Okay, so Aris will get one. Let me write it down in case. Okay, so which one do you like? Let me off my...
There you go.
Okay, so which one do you like? Aris. Aris is my student.
Oh
my
gosh.
Who the heck is Aris? Oh, okay. Never mind. Damn it. Okay, right, let me ask another question. Another question. No students, all right? Oh my gosh. Okay. I can draw you sketch anytime. You don't need me to give you this. Okay, what are the two software that I use to paint my art? What are the two software that I always use, side by side?
There you go.
Dum 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 dum. We need some sound effects or something.
Yeah.
Let's see if I can provide you with some.
What are the two softwares?
Drum rolls. Oh wait.
Something to build attention.
Oh. Okay. So. Well done. Okay, so Wu Jia Yue, are you my student? No, right? Okay. So Wu Jia Yue got a sketch.
You should check his Facebook just to make sure he's not secretly a student as well.
Secret student, ninja.
So Wu Jia Yue, you'll get one sketch from me. So, which one do you like? Hey guys, stop talking.
Can you put it higher? Can you put
it
higher?
But they're a minute back in time, so.
Can you put it a little bit higher so we can see the boobs as well?
Oh yeah, of course. Yeah.
Okay.
Darek, why is it so hilarious?
It's important, you know?
Yeah,
right. I would pick the left one, to be honest. Mm.
All right. We can see.
So, Ujaya, can you? The one on the left is this one,
but
right?
But you're mirrored. So, yeah. Which one is left?
The front boobs.
What the fuck?
That's okay, side. That one's the side boob.
Okay, I don't care. All right, this one. All right? Okay. Okay, next one. Next one, huh?
All right.
Let me see. Name me one of my favorite artists.
Ooh.
Name me one of my favorite artists.
Yeah. Who listened?
Oh, he won the front-facing one. Okay, I keep
the front-facing one. Beginning of the session.
Can I participate? Is this allowed?
No. Come on. What's my favorite artist? Just name one of them.
Okay. I think it's catching up already. Still not. There you go.
James Jean. Okay. So Jolita got it.
There you go. Perfect. All right. So we got our sketches out. Thank you so much for this little contest. Our chat will blow up for a long time now. I guess that's a... we have one last question, right? A question that we ask every guest, every time, at least we try. Would you rather be a Godzilla or a billionaire, and why?
I would rather be a Godzilla.
I think the Katamari reference.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. I played this game called Rampage when I was young. You know this game called Rampage? Then you have to climb the building and destroy the building like King Kong? Yeah.
Why would you be a Godzilla? Why not a million?
I think I have always been a good guy. I would like to be a bad guy sometime and really
that's a good point.
Just trash something. Yeah.
Perfect. Okay, thank you, Stanley, so much for contributing to the Level Up experience and to this session in general.
No problem. Thank you
for a great demo and for a giveaway and for participating today. We're really pleased to have you on our platform and really happy that I hope a lot of people enjoyed our session today. Guys, I don't want to give you any specific dates in terms of the next session. I can tell you that it will happen soon, and it will be sooner than half a year, that's for sure. And we will have another great artist for us to talk and exchange thoughts with and share experience with. So again, thank you. Thanks, Jonas. Thanks, Darek. Love you guys. Bye-bye. Yeah. Yep. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much for Level Up. Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks, man. All right. Yeah. Talk to you soon, guys. See you.
Yep.
Bye.
Take care.
Bye-bye. Bye. Take care.